So it is a very elaborate and meticulously planned law to bring into existence something which is very special, taking all kinds of precautions to ensure this particular outfit would really approximate to the ideals that the higher judiciary had visualized and would deliver. So there's a lot of promise. There's a lot of promise that from those amateurish efforts that we had earlier, which had a very tortuous path of evolution and then demise, this would stay, and this is the need of the hour. Instead of looking into specific cases decided by the NGT, because the volume of cases dealt and decided is humongous, as you would be seeing, that in just about a year, 10 years of its life, the kind of work that has been done by NGT is something which is unimaginable. And so, instead of going case by case, the idea is to consolidate in one place a set of outcomes of its consideration of cases. And in this particular part, what will be done is to consolidate them in about some 20 to 25 instances of cases and case laws, especially as to the outcome of those, to really carry out what can be described as an assessment and an evaluation of the work of National Green Tribunal. So while giving a little bit of a peep into what it has been doing, you are also looking into an evaluation of its work, a performance audit. A decadal experience of a specialized body for accessing and securing justice on all matters concerning the environment. What we have before us are not less than 3,500 odd decisions and orders. In terms of volume, this is mind-boggling. And how do you really make an assessment? You need a set of criteria as to how you are going to really, how useful, how valuable, how beneficial, how effective, how desirable the working of this National Green Tribunal. And for that, a few markers can be listed out just as below. Number one, its responsiveness to environmental problems, how responsive it has been. The knowledge and expertise of knowledge judges and members. Facilitation of access to justice. Fourthly, its status, authority, and level of independence in conducting proceedings, in delivering judgments, acting without fear or favor. Fourthly, its access to scientific and technical expertise. Fifth, ability to operate as a multi-door courthouse. Sixth, expeditiousness and economically viable recourse for resolution of disputes. Seventh, flexibility, innovativeness, and value-adding functions to the existing statutory remedies. And eighth, contribution to the development of environmental jurisprudence. These are some of the eight indicative factors which may perhaps help us in doing a bit of an evaluation of the work of this body, of the host of 3,000 odd or 4,000 odd cases decided by it. But in addition, it's also very necessary that it is not just these that would actually steer our thinking and our assessment and our judgment of the performance of this, but it also should include the consequential impressions and the impacts of the host of instructions, orders, judgments, actions taken by NGT in the course of any case that it had taken up on the concerned and their responses by way of their approaches, attitudes and action. Here I mean, how have the courts of law have taken its decisions? How have the administration to whom these are directed have been sensitive to their decisions? How have the very corporate entities against whom certain strictures and orders are passed have responded and complied? And how have me, you and every member of the civil society have reacted to the orders of that? These are also indicative and helpful for us to draw a conclusion as to whether it is a good entity, something that is useful, it should continue, it is doing great work, let it continue, or it is a white elephant. So how do we decide on that? For that, I have just put together a set of indicators to decide and determine its utility, value and worth. And on the basis of this, we will examine maybe about a couple of dozens of instances, orders, directions, judgments, decisions given by NGT. Let us first have a panoramic view of the accomplishments of NGT. Number one, 10 years since its establishment, over 3,500 judgments and orders covering a whole range of issues. Look at the issues covered by it. Industrial operations, natural resource management, mining operations, water, air, noise, quality issues, waste management, environmental compensation. Such a range. Number two, it has emerged as a critical player in environmental regulation by passing very, very strict orders on issues ranging from pollution to deforestation to waste management and the like. The sweep is too vast. Number three, it has offered a path, almost a highway, for the evolution of environmental jurisprudence by setting up an alternative dispute resolution forum. Fourth, a real help in reducing the burden of litigation in the higher courts on environmental matters. Fifth, in terms of its procedures, it has been less formal, less expensive, and a faster way of resolving environment-related disputes. Sixth, till now, it has played a very crucial role in curbing environmentally damaging activities. Seventh, it is instrumental in ensuring that the environment impact assessment process is strictly observed by all the concerned. Eighth, it has not only flagged key environmental issues of the country, but brought a new dynamic functioning style for sensitizing government machinery to act fast and intensify its surveillance and vigilance mechanisms. To give an illustrative example, it has actually dispensed with the process in recent times of referring complaints and petitions filed before it for seeking para-wise comments from different departments of the government. You know the procedure. Normally, when actions are initiated before NGT on various issues, NGT would refer that matter to different government agencies. Look, this is the complaint. This is the grievance. What is your response to it? Give us para-wise comments on each, addressing each one of these issues, and on the basis of which we will be able to make out as to what is the grievance, what is the action, and what needs to be done. This is what they used to do. I think for 6-7 years they were doing this. As it so turned out that it became a time-consuming exercise. And second, through this particular process, even the governmental and other agencies to whom these references were made took their own sweet time in responding, providing information, and it caused delays. I'm not saying deliberate delays, but I'm saying delays on account of the procedure adopted and followed. You know that this is a very dynamic body. What procedure it lays down now, it can change to suit the occasion. And that's what it did. Instead of doing this kind of an exercise and getting complete responses to the notices issued, what it did was it launched an online filing of complaints and petitions on payment of a fee of 1,000 rupees even without engaging an advocate. Of course, this has been a matter of great debate in law practice circles, but I am only looking at the positive side. The negative side we will examine later. On the positive side, see, you have to engage an advocate. The advocate has to put together arguments, and these issues that are being tabled before the NGT would be referred to different departments of the government for the responses, would be referred to different corporate entities for the responses, and you have to wait for a long period of time. But supposing the complaint is going to be filed online, instantaneous. I have a complaint, and the next moment it's already on the table of the NGT. NGT would go through it, and all that it would do is it would immediately refer to the different agencies. It would instantaneously decide in its meeting that this is the kind of thing, and these are the issues, and these are the departments, these are the corporate entities which need have to respond. So through mails, a particular point of time is fixed for each one of them to respond. They started entertaining mails and letters received by it, admitting them as petitions. The ostensible idea is to dispense with the rigmarole procedures involved in seeking and securing information, responses, reactions, actions, etc., and achieve them at shortest possible period of time. This is definitely an innovation. To mention a few other efforts of NGT, which can be considered as major achievements of NGT, it played and still is playing a pivotal role in expeditious disposal of cases by constituting committees of central and state government representatives with experts drawn from very renowned technological institutions and eminent institutions. In selected matters, it preferred appointment of retired judges of Supreme Court and High Courts for taking stock of situation and establishing interdepartmental coordination among states. On paper, this looks like just yet another innovative measure. But to understand the value and significance of it, a little elaboration is required. NGT, with all the expertise it has, when cases come before it, involving very complex environmental issues, even with the expertise and the legal skills that are there in this particular body, it may not be adequate. And so you need infusion of expertise in very rarefied field of knowledge, skill, understanding, and research. And so you need to reach out to those who do have that kind of information, skill, knowledge, tap that and utilize them. And so, in order that NGT's time is saved, these expert bodies are constituted to aid, assist, guide, and advise NGT. Actually, this is a technique adopted by the high courts and Supreme Court. The same thing NGT has also adopted because its work had become so voluminous. And each of the members devoting time and energy for each of these issues, getting deeper into each of these specialized areas, started becoming very difficult. And time is at the essence. And if you want to save time, you needed to bring in more people, and expert advice is something that was sought. The other thing that you must note is establishment of departmental coordination among different agencies of state. All throughout our study of environmental law, we have found that this is a very serious problem. The problem of coordination. The problem of one department of the government working in tandem with the other department of the government. Time and again, we have already noticed and we have mentioned in our discourse and discussion that environment is not something which would operate in silos or in compartments. The land, the air, the water, they have a kind of a symmetry in them. They work in one rhythm. The divisions that you have for different departments of the government are only for administrative convenience. But they need have to evolve means and mechanisms of working together to be in tune with that natural rhythm to make their performance not in any way conflicting with each other's functioning, but as a symphony. So far, in the working of environmental laws or any of that, that kind of a symphony was never generated. NGT took steps in bringing secretaries and heads of departments of different agencies of state to come together in a coordination committee. When a particular problem came, the NGT would constitute this body and would ask them, sit, deliberate, and then give us your opinion so that we can pass it as an order. A real great innovation, a much needed requirement accomplished by NGT. The tribunal played a very great role. I'm just referring to the fairly recent ones, just the last year, 2019. And you must have read in the newspapers and also would have, even today, you are getting informations about that. That's about the cleaning of Ganga and Yamuna. And this is largely due to a particular panel that was created within the National Green Tribunal, which took a lot of effort to highlight the urgency of the matter and to quote from one of its observations, every drop of pollution in Ganga is a matter of great concern. And what did NGT do? In consideration of this particular issue, it has expressed dissatisfaction over all that was done in cleaning the river Yamuna, and it directed the Delhi, Haryana and Uttar Pradesh government to submit a performance guarantee. You must note here, a performance guarantee of 10 crores each. See, we have given you directions. Clean up this river and make it get restored to its earlier condition, or at least something which is manageable condition, and we have not been doing it as we have expected you to. And so we lay down a requirement from you. Give us a performance guarantee of 10 crores. Each one of the states, it's a direction to the states. So making governments accountable for commissions and omissions and almost imposing a kind of a penalty. You give this guarantee, then only we will rest assured. It directed Uttarakhand and UP pollution control boards to publicize Ganga's water quality at strategic locations every month. So how monitoring has to be done, how quality control needed to be established is encapsulated in this idea. and publicize Ganga's water quality at strategic locations every month. And the objective is to indicate the extent of it being fit for bathing and drinking. Look at another order. It instructed Uttarakhand to ensure no illegal camping takes place on the banks of the river Ganga and its tributaries. And this happened last year again. It slapped a 100 crore rupee fine, not on an individual or a private entity, on Tamil Nadu government. What was the problem? It was about the inordinate delay in removing encroachments. Where? The rivers Adyar and Kuvam had this problem of encroachments, and instructions were given to them that these encroachments are causing pollution to the river Adyar and Kuvam, and the government was required to remove encroachments within a particular period of time. And the government failed to conform to these orders. And look the result. The government could not get away with this delay. Could not get away with whatever kind of lame explanations it gave according to NGT. It slapped a fine. No, there is a failure. This is what you have to pay up. Pay up for your delays, laxity in your performance, and non-observance of our instructions to our satisfaction. Another incident which caught the eye of NGT concerned forest fires, and these were on the increase over a period of time, and it felt that dealing with each one of these cases will not be sufficient. What it did was it directed the Ministry of Environment and Forest and Climate Change to do a study of all that and come up with a report of all information of such occurrences in the last 5 years and identify why they're recurring and why they're recurring with increasing frequency and what are those trouble spots which need urgent, quick action and the measures that need have to be taken. A very detailed report was required to be submitted by the ministry to the NGT. So it's actually galvanizing the highest authority concerning environment to ensure that there is some performance on the part of administration and a better accounting of their actions by themselves. There is another important order passed by NGT, and this concerns regulation of use of RO purifiers. You know that in the market you have what are called as RO purifiers, or purifiers which adopt this technology called as reverse osmosis. And this became a very rampant thing as to whether this is the answer for clean water, and there were scientific evidences that were made available that this is not really a solution for drinking water. And so a bit of a scientific study that helped the NGT to direct the government to prohibit such purifiers where total dissolved solids in water were below 500 milligrams per liter, because you don't require such purifiers in such cases, and it's unnecessary waste of expenditure, and people should be sensitized to this in this regard. Look at another instance. Serious problems of air pollution, which is a bane in all major cities in India. And what did NGT do? It dealt with matters of air pollution in 122 cities, not one, two, 122, where the air pollution levels have been exceeding norms. It directed the Central Pollution Control Board, look, what are you doing? Get into action. Prepare action plans. And these action plans are so prepared, you ensure that you do a minute scrutiny of them and approve them for such cities and get them implemented by state agencies. So it was actually a direction to the state agencies to prepare plans and then get it verified, tested, checked, and with expert hands of the Central Pollution Control Board approved, and the state agencies to take back those approved plans and put them into application just in one stroke. So many things was achieved by NGT. So in terms of the breadth of approach of not just being a micromanaging environmental problem issue, it took on Goliaths. 122 cities is no joke. Look at another one. Its presence was felt even in far-off areas like Lakshadweep. Lakshadweep, you know, it's an archipelago where there is a problem of drinking water. And this is not a problem that arose today. It has been there, and way back in 1980s, there have been decisions delivered by the High Court and the Supreme Court. And one important case that comes to mind is the case of Attakoya Thangal. In that case, the courts have actually ordered for the government to do and take such adequate measures to ensure the drinking water problem of the people there are solved, a basic necessity. And this was in 1980s and 90s when high courts and Supreme Court were involved in it. The year is 2018-19. NGT found that not much was done. So what did it do? It asked the administration to ensure supply of potable water to villages and implement the action plan, which was made available to it by the Central Government Groundwater Board in this regard, quite some time back. There is already a plan. There is already step-by-step implementation of it, already on paper, translated into action. Don't allow it to hibernate. So NGT meant business here. No delays. This is a basic necessity, and you cannot procrastinate or delay. Budgetary constraints or whatever should not come in the way. Look at the visionary approach here. In another instance, it directed setting up of mechanisms to inform public on severe condition days of air pollution and issue advisories for taking precautionary measures. So when we talk of weather forecasts, we only talk about whether it would rain or it would be severe heat or anything like that. But now one more dimension was added, that at some points of time in the day, in the week, in a particular season, in a particular locality, the air pollution levels are going to be high. Scientific fact. And if this is a scientific fact, then the authorities need have to have a very clear duty to inform public as to the kind of precautions that they have to take during that critical period so that their health is protected. Really a visionary approach. And this is an icing to the cake. Here was a multinational automobile manufacturing giant. Look at the order passed here. I think from the decision itself, you'll make out what the facts are. It acted tough on pollution caused by cars. And it slapped a 500 crore rupee fine, not few thousands or lakhs, 500 crore rupees fine on this German auto giant, Volkswagen. For what? For damaging the environment. How did it damage? Through a cheat device in its diesel cars in India. Diesel cars. After Bharat 1, 2, 3, 4, the standards stipulated need have to have filters so that from the exhaust, the polluting substance will not get released. And what did this company do? It inserted a device in its cars, which are diesel cars, to say that this is safe and it is sufficient to ensure that the level of pollution would not be beyond the limit prescribed. But that was actually a lie. to make the corporate entity accountable for its action of misleading people, somebody had to act tough, and that was NGT here. So he did not spare a multinational giant also, very rare, one of those rare occasions when corporate responsibility was very clearly established and action taken. Some more instances, just to demonstrate the kind of work done by the National Green Tribunal, which is unprecedented in any legal system by any environmental court anywhere in the world, appointed a committee headed by a former Delhi High Court judge about what to deal with. How many? 52,000 industrial units which were operating illegally in Delhi residential areas. Look at that. How do you get license? How somebody would allow somebody to operate even without license? What about the health, hygiene and well-being of people? What are the authorities doing? NGT said we cannot keep quiet. We constitute a high power committee to look into this problem and then report for actions for us to be implemented by the authorities without further delay. It did not spare the railways department. In another instance, it insisted the railway department to identify and develop what? At least 36 railway stations as eco-smart stations, and asked it to maintain cleanliness on platforms and ensure liability of officers for non-compliance. NGT made inquiries with Punjab, Haryana and UP governments in another instance as to what are their plans in tackling, I think you are familiar with this, this is happening year after year, the problem of crop residue burning, what we call it the stubble burning, which is a major contributor to air pollution in Delhi. And air pollution in Delhi is actually contributed by what happens in its neighborhood. Delhi is a kind of a very interesting city ecologically. Its topography is such that it stands on a kind of a platform which is surrounded by elevated areas or hilly areas. And so whatever happens in the elevated areas will come and settle down in this valley kind of a situation, a tough kind of a situation that Delhi is in. So there is entry of polluting substance, no exit. So Delhiites would get choked if there is pollution in the neighborhood. And what did NGT do? It summoned the authorities in the neighboring states bordering Delhi. What you have done about this crop residue burning? And it directed constitution of a special cells in the office of the chief secretary of Delhi and in each of these neighboring states to monitor air pollution and take action. Its work on solid waste management is another phenomenal work. On solid waste management, it has the Delhi government and civic bodies, please follow this carefully and underline this, to deposit 250 crores in an escrow account. For what? To facilitate waste removal from landfill sites. Money should be available in an escrow account so that this work would be carried out without any hindrance, difficulty, or for want of funds. An unprecedented move. More unprecedented move comes now. NGT summoned the chief secretaries of states and union territories demanding compliance status on key issues like solid and plastic waste, polluted river stretches, sand mining and air pollution in cities. I have referred to a host of other instances as well from the slides that you are able to make out how unauthorized industrial activities were not properly dealt with by the New Delhi government, and for the failures of the government demanding the government to deposit 25 crores of rupees before CPCB for failure, like a fine imposed. Or even a young boy of 16 years old, when he approached NGT, for what? To stop e-commerce giants. We have online transactions occurring in a very big way now. And you know the packaging material that these commercial giants, e-commerce giants like Amazon and Flipkart, the packing material is so much. What you do with the packaged material when it is actually taken for consumption, what do you do with package? Something did have to be done. And for that, CPCB was asked to prepare a report and submit it to NGT for further instruction to these corporate giants. There are quite a few ecologically sensitive areas. And some or the other, not much has been done, or whatever that has been done by administration is inadequate to take care of these ecologically fragile areas like Kullu, Manali, Leodganj, Mahabaleshwar, Vaishno Devi, Rohtang Pass. Year after year, they have one ecological problem or the other. Floods or landslides or even problems of encroachment, illegal encroachments. So, environmental management plans for these are a must because these are very sensitive areas. And so, to the concerned authorities and departments, an environment management plan was required to be formulated as per the instructions of NGT. NGT's attention turned towards the grubbiest rivers of India, especially certain river stretches which are rendered contaminated on account of one of the major contributors, thermal power plants and coal mining. These have contributed to a lot of pollution of a number of rivers, and especially with regard to Sonebhadra and Singrauli areas, for the restitution of environment and for rejuvenation of 351 polluted river stretches and for degraded areas on account of mining in Meghalaya. There is something called as rat hole mining. It's a mechanism. And as a result of which, outwardly you would not see much of a change, but the integrity of that particular ecosystem would be so fragile, so affected, that any time major mishaps may occur. So, for the restitution of that ecosystem there, and for the rejuvenation of rivers, are a number of issues. The NGT took monumental decisions and gave directions for actions. I can go on with any number of examples, but I think this is a sufficient slice of information of the dimensions and the depths of action and measures taken by the National Green Tribunal, a very impressive record of achievements. And that too in a very short span of time, of life of just a decade by this body. Nowhere in the world these kinds of actions were initiated and acted upon by just about a dozen people sitting in the headquarters at Delhi and in its four benches in different parts of India. What high courts and supreme courts found it impossible or very difficult to act upon, NGT was able to achieve. So in terms of its achievements, truly, really mind-boggling.